Hey guys, and welcome to this video. I'm Pratik, and in this video, we're going to be looking at ways for you to ace your situational judgement test. In this video, we're going to be looking at what the situational judgement test is, the types of questions that you can expect to find in it, and also some hints and tips to get you through the situational judgement test during the COVID pandemic. The situational judgement test is a test that is used when you apply for dental core training or foundation dentistry. It's a method of assessing an individual's character and it's part of the application process. Unfortunately, situational judgement tests are notoriously difficult to do well. Before I go on in this video, obviously a lot of this is still very, very fluid because of the COVID pandemic, so it's important that you constantly check the CopDend website. This year for the application, this test is more important than previous years because it forms a greater basis for your overall rank. This year, for example, with dental core training, the situational judgement test makes up 33% of your mark. If you want to know a bit more about the application process itself, I've done another video on this, so please make sure you go and check that out. One of the reasons situational judgement tests can be particularly difficult is the correct answer for each question is created by a panel of professionals or a group of professionals, and it takes the average answer that that group gives. So what you might give as what you think is the correct answer may not align with what this group has given. This year, with the COVID pandemic, the situational judgement test is either going to be done at home or it may be done at a Pearson VUE testing centre. Like I've mentioned, the situational judgement test isn't a test of clinical knowledge, it is more a test of assessing you as a character and your professional attributes. The aspects and attributes that are being assessed through the situational judgement test include your professionalism, decision making, your ability to provide patient-centered care, your ability to cope under pressure, and also your critical thinking skills. There are generally two types of questions in the situational judgement test. The first question is rank in order following responses to a particular situation. So you are given five options and you need to rank these from most appropriate, first answer, to least appropriate. Some important things to consider with this question is each item and each answer should be treated independently. In terms of my strategy for answering this type of question, usually when you look at the answers, there is one really obvious correct answer or the most correct answer, and there is one really obvious most inappropriate answer. And so I would usually put the most appropriate answer and the least appropriate answer and then look at filling in the gap in between. This is also important when you think about the marking. If you put the correct order of letters, you get 4 marks for each correct one. So that's a total of 20 marks. For every position off you are from the correct order, you lose a mark. So that means if you get the most appropriate and the least appropriate answers in the wrong position, they have the biggest chance of losing you marks. So here we have an example. So the question scenario is this. A 28-year-old patient, Amber, attends for a crown fit. When you have replaced Amber's temporary crown with a permanent one, you show Amber the final result in the mirror. However, Amber starts to cry and say, "It looks awful, change it. The temporary crown was better." And we have the five options that are presented. So these options are, advise Amber to wear the crown for 10 days before returning to discuss how she is feeling. If we consider this option, it's not great because you're not dealing with Amber's frustration by sending her away with the crown that she's not happy with. So it wouldn't be going as my most or least appropriate. I'd probably go somewhere in the middle at this point. We have option B, which is seek advice from your educational supervisor. Again, this is not a bad response. It does mean though that you're already seeking help rather than considering the situation yourself. So it's not towards the latter half of your order. It would be towards the top, but probably still not the most appropriate. Then we have option C, tell Amber that if she wants a better crown, she will have to have this done privately. Now immediately, as soon as I read this, I'm putting this as my least appropriate option because it doesn't deal with Amber's problem. And also you're offering something privately, which really probably shouldn't be private. Then we have option D, which is review the before and after photographs with Amber, highlighting the improvement. Again, not a bad option. You're dealing with this yourself, you're understanding Amber's concern, but you're trying to highlight the difference between before and after, as patients may not realize this. So again, I'd probably put this towards the top half of my answers. And then we have option E, which is allow Amber to calm herself before exploring her feelings about the crown in more depth. Immediately, I would be putting this as the most appropriate option because you're understanding that Amber's not happy about something, and this means then you can try and deal with the problem and rectify it for her. So we've already looked at the most appropriate and least appropriate. So now I have the gap in between to fill. If you look back at the options, like I said, the fitting the crown for 10 days and asking to come back doesn't seem like a really good option for me. So I'd probably put this second to last. Now we have the options B and D. These are probably the ones that I get most likely confused with. In all honesty, looking at these options, I would probably choose D as my second most appropriate option because I'm still taking ownership of the situation and I'm trying to rectify rectify it with the patient. My middle option would probably be B. I'd speak to my supervisor. You have to remember that when you're answering these questions, you have to think in the mind of a foundation dentist or a dental core trainee. So you have supervisors available. You're not expected to be competent in everything. And so often asking for help or speaking to a supervisor may not necessarily be the best option, but it is going to be up there. If we look at the final order, we've got E, D, B, A, and C. Now, if we compare it to the correct order, that is the answer that is stated, and you can pause and read the description there. If you were to mark this, you would get 20 marks because every letter is in the correct position. However, let's look at a scenario where we mix the letters up. So now I'm going to mix those two letters up that I was a bit unsure about. So we can see that the second and third letters are in the wrong position. So they're one off their correct position. And if we look at the mark scheme, you will see that we would get 3 marks for each of these answers. So in total, you would get 18 marks for this question. Now, the second type of question is where you have to choose the 3 most appropriate linked answers to a situation. If you remember, like I mentioned, in the first type of question, we treat each answer as an independent answer. But in this question, we have to choose the 3 actions that, when linked together, are the most appropriate response to a situation. For each correct answer, you get 4 marks. This means that it can often be a bit more difficult to pick up marks on these questions, because if you get one of these wrong, you get nothing for it, as compared to the first type of question, where if you're maybe a couple of letters off, you still may pick up marks. Again, let's look at a practice question to see how to answer these. The scenario that is presented to us is, you are replacing a broken filling for an anxious patient. During the procedure, the dental nurse stops you. She tells you that the patient is not coping well with the procedure and is becoming increasingly upset and agitated. You were not aware that the patient was in distress. And so now we're giving 8 options, and we have to choose the 3 most appropriate linked options. So if we look at the options, we have discuss with the patient what is distressing them, apologize to the patient if you have caused him any distress, advise the dental nurse following the consultation not to question your work in front of the patient in the future, ask the dental nurse how you should proceed, ask your educational supervisor to take over the procedure, ask the patient whether he would like you to continue with the procedure, inform the dental nurse that the patient does not seem distressed to you, reflect on why you did not notice that the patient was agitated and upset following the consultation. Immediately, some of these we can rule out. If we look at the option of asking the nurse how to proceed, it's not the nurse's job to determine how you proceed. It is you, it's your responsibility. So immediately, this isn't an appropriate action. So we can remove this. So then option C, advising the dental nurse, isn't really helpful because you're not dealing with the problem then and there. But asking the educational supervisor, again, okay, you're dealing with the procedure being carried out, but you've not explored the patient's concerns, you've not dealt with the distress, and you're not learning anything from it. You're essentially giving up, abandoning the procedure, and getting a supervisor to take over. Option G, informing the dental nurse that the patient doesn't seem distressed, I don't think is very good, again, because you're dismissing the dental nurse's concern, and also you're potentially dismissing the patient's concern. So this leaves us with 4 options. All of these would seem relatively appropriate answers in my view, but we have to consider which 3 of these, when linked together, would be the most appropriate way to proceed. And if I look at these 3 options, the one option that is standing out to me as not quite fitting in with the others is apologizing to the patient. But if you look at the wording of the scenario, and wording is really important with these questions, you are not aware that the patient is in distress, and apologizing unnecessarily isn't going to gain anything, and it may in fact undermine the patient's confidence in you. So if I think about it and I look at the other 3 options, it seems like a relatively logical order of response. So I would discuss with the patient what is distressing them, because this would confirm whether they are being distressed or not. I would then ask them, do they want me to carry on? Again, this is dealing with their concern, because if they are distressed, they may not want you to, so you're dealing with this. And then you're also reflecting. This is the answer. Again, the explanation is there if you want to read it. So if we were to mark this, it would be 12 marks. So we've looked at the 2 main types of questions and a couple of examples relating to them. But now let's look at some important hints and tips on how you can try and maximize your score. The first thing is making sure you read all the relevant resources. This isn't a test of your clinical knowledge, it's a test of your professional attributes. So looking at your professional documentation, your GDC standards, your scope of practice, your FGDP guidelines, all of these are far more important. If you are sitting the SJTs from home, then it's really important that you check your laptop is compatible and is working properly with the software. Ensure your environment is also appropriate with no distractions and you're in a quiet room so that you're not affected by any other noise. You most likely will also have to show your room to the examiner and make sure therefore that it is clean and there's no one else sat in this room, because there is a risk that you may be cheating if they are there. The next tip, which I've alluded to, is reading the question carefully. Wording is really important in these types of questions. For example, there's a practice question where a patient presents with an ulcer, and one of the options is that you tell the patient that it may be oral cancer. That is a very big difference from an answer that says it is oral cancer, because the connotations from both of them are very different. So look at the wording and pay careful attention to the wording. One of the big things that often a lot of people struggle with these types of questions is when you're answering them, you're not answering them in a real world type situation. You're answering them from an idealistic situation. Now, a lot of us have been in some of these situations. You may have been through them in dental school or in your foundation year, and your response will have been very different to what actually the question is looking for. But you need to change your mindset and you need to think, what would happen in an ideal world? The next tip is, depending on the level at which you're sitting in, you're only expected to have the level of knowledge and competency as that level of application. So if you're applying for a foundation dentistry, you're only expected in the questions to have that level of knowledge and competency. Next, always put the patient's best interests first. As we looked in the example of Amber with the crown, the most appropriate options were those where we are discussing with the patient their concern. We're putting their interests first. The last big tip, and this is something that I found particularly difficult sitting situational judgment tests, is the problem with time. You're often very pressurized in terms of answering these questions in a set time period. This is why the hints and tips I mentioned earlier on in terms of picking the most appropriate and the least appropriate and filling them in, or getting rid of answers that you know right off the bat aren't correct, helps speed things up for you. I would try not to sit and ponder on a question too long, because it may mean that I miss 3 or 4 questions later on. It's true, a lot of people say you can't practice for a situational judgment test. I agree to that to a degree, but you can practice how to deal with these questions in a timely manner, and also simply how to answer these questions in a certain format. This is where practicing becomes really important, and you can take a huge amount of value from practicing both dental and medical questions, because the principles are the same. This leads me onto the resources that I'd like to recommend to you. These include the Dental Foundation Interview Guide, the Foundation Programme online practice papers that are available, Oxford Assess and Progress, and the 250 SJTs for Foundation Year Entry. I hope you found this useful. If you did, please like, comment, subscribe, and hit the notification bell. If you do have any suggestions or any questions, please leave a comment or contact me on one of the social media handles. My recommendation in this video is the Scottish Dental Clinical Effectiveness Programme, or SDCEP. They provide a huge number of resources and guidelines for dentists to follow in day-to-day practice. Again, links are in the description. Please make sure to check them out. If you are sitting the dental core training application and situational judgment test this year, then good luck. I will be putting some more videos up in order to help with the application process, so stay tuned for them. Till then, take care.